Hello, church family. My name is Cheryl Hagel. I've been attending Broadway for the last 26 plus years. And if this were normal times, you would probably be seeing me at one of three places, either the coffee bar or the nursery looking after our precious little tinies, or even probably sitting in pew number four with Brad and chatting up my neighbors on that side of the church. So since we aren't in those normal times, I get to do this instead. So we're gonna pray together and just invite God into our service today. Father God, we come to you with hearts that are in awe of your goodness, faithfulness and beauty, and above all, your abundant love. Thank you for surrounding us with beauty. We are blessed, a blessed people to live here in the valley, between the mountains, near the strength of the rivers, the incredible vastness of the farmers' fields, and the breathtaking beauty of the changing seasons. And when we forget all of this goodness, Lord, thank you for reminding us of your love through the quiet radiance of the rainbow. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness, your unending grace. You see our self-doubts, our anxieties, our hurt, our fear, and how we can sometimes allow all of that to overwhelm us, blocking you from our lives. Yet, Lord, you remind us and you remain steadfast in your love for us. You invite us to heap all on your shoulders and to rest in the knowledge you are with us. You will take our burdens and give us peace. Lord, there's a lot going on in this great big world right now. We come to you and ask for your will, your plan to unfold in our land. We pray for our elected leaders and ask that you give them wisdom, gentleness, and a genuine love for the people they are elected to serve. We ask for a coming together of divided interests. Lord, this feels like as though we're asking for a miracle. Thank you for our leaders here at Broadway. Thank you for Gary, for Zach, and for Joanne. You've blessed us all through them. Thank you for the members of our lead team and the various committees that have worked so diligently and with such care to serve our church family. Finally, we pray that your truth would dwell in our hearts and our minds as we hear from your word today. Amen.
The King. the Father's love, destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned, but suffered as if he did. It's all authority, every victory is yours. It's all authority, every victory is yours.
We have an announcement for our Broadway folks here. We are going to begin to have small group meetings at church in the first week of November, so we'll be looking for the announcements. Care groups can come and meet. If you are not in a group, there will be an opportunity to connect and socialize and have some good discussion with other people. And we're going to be looking at some of the scriptures from our Roman series here that we've been preaching through. So look forward to coming to church and hopefully seeing you on one night of the week starting in November. So today we're looking at Romans chapter 8, verses 8 to 14. I've called it love till the end of time. Love is a very popular word throughout history. The Beatles songs I heard on radio this week have the word love in their songs over 600 times. Within the Christian circles, it's been commonplace to draw rigid distinctions among the several Greek words that are translated love. There's the first one, it's a Greek word that would mean family love or instinctual love, like a father or mother for a child. Then we have the, you know, good friends love. Plato talks about a love that has no physical attraction. The term is platonic, so it's attraction without physical connection that way. Then there's the Greek word for sexual or physical attraction and passion. And one we're familiar with is agape, which is unconditional, a will-based love, to will the good of another. Verses like, God so loved the world he gave. That's agape. It's family love. It's instinctual love. It's agape love. God is love. That's his instinct. He has will-based love toward us, and we're to be the same, to love the Lord our God, to love our neighbor as ourself. And so here we were going to read that we are to love till the end of time. We are to have agape. We may be instinctual to love people. So reading Romans chapter 13, 8 to 10. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other commands there may be are summed up in this one command, love. Be instinctually loving and willing for the good of your neighbor as you are to yourself. Verse 10 says, love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is a fulfillment of the law. The immediate context in these verses is the debt we have to the governing authorities. We have a debt to pay taxes, respect, and honor. We have debts to continually pay, Paul says here, and they are a debt of our mind and our heart, not a debt of our finances. Two other letters that have strong references regarding our attitudes toward governing authorities that we're called to obey and love them is Titus 3, 1 to 3. Paul expects submission to the rulers and authorities, but the emphasis is slightly different. Paul tells Titus to remind the people to be obedient to the governing authorities, to be ready to do whatever is good, to slander no one, to be peaceable, to be considerate, and show true humility toward all people. So submission to the rulers and authorities is the first behavior listed in Titus. It's followed by be obedient, be ready to take honest work. Don't slander anyone. Don't be quarrelsome. Be considerate. Show gentleness to all people. That's how we're to treat governing authorities. This list would suggest that the concern is with disorderly and perhaps subversive behavior that people were thinking of doing, maybe revolting. And Paul says, no, nothing is said about the nature of the ruling authorities or submission to them. The motivation for proper conduct, as we read later, is Christian experience in the other verses following this in Titus. He says the lives of Christians are to be characterized by the opposite of what he lists here. At one time, he says, you were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved. You lived with malice, and you envied, and you hated one another, and you were hated. But then the love and kindness of God appeared, and he saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit. So this is how we are to behave to everybody. This is the reality of a genuine conversion. A renewed mind has a certain way of looking at authorities and governing authorities. And there is a debt to love, not to bring division or trouble or damage. Paul also says something in 1 Timothy chapter 2. This is the specific command in verse 1 is to offer prayers of various kinds for all people, including kings and all in high positions. The motivation is that we may be lead a quiet life in godliness and dignity. Such a life is good and acceptable before God our Savior, who wishes for all people to be saved. These two passages invoke the will of God as a motivation for submission and respect. This is what God wants. They are optimistic about the government's role to punish evil and reward good. Neither Romans nor these texts believe the governing authorities will become the enemies of the church, even though Romans was written to people who had experienced the government's disruptive force. He says, work with them, be ordered. All of these texts believe that the governing authorities will practice and promote justice. That's what God has ordained for them to do. So these texts are wisdom. They're wisdom teaching. They assume the existence of governing structures and authorities for the ordering of human society, specifically the control of evil and the promotion of the common good. That's what we talked about last week. The governing structures and authorities are seen as necessary for the welfare of the human community. Therefore, they should be respected, honored, and submitted to. Have debt, Paul says. Have debt. Have you ever heard that before? Not only just have debt, have a continuing debt, but the reference is a debt of love, an obligation of love. And it's best understood in this entire context. Remember, he says, bless those who persecute you. That's love. Do not repay evil with evil. That's a debt of love. Do not act out with revenge. That's love. Do not resist the governing authorities. That's love. You're obligated to love everyone. This interpretation is anchored with an interpretive comment here. He says, the law is summed up in one word, and that is love, love, love. Love is not some undefined ideal. Its practice is measured by the observance of specific commandments. It's not just up in the air, not able to figure out. It is not possible to love and also commit adultery, kill, steal, or covet. Very objective. Paul uses the idea of Christian obligation to pay taxes in verse 7, and he springs it into a metaphor about Christian indebtedness to love one another in verse 8. We learned in chapter 14 a few weeks ago that if they did not respect each other's convictions on disputable matters, they no longer were acting in love. This is that will to love. Paul strenuously argued that the Galatians should regard love as a fulfillment of the Torah. When Christians act in love, they fulfill the righteous requirements of the law. Paul explains that the way the Roman believers are to pay their debt of love is by doing the last four of the Ten Commandments here. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not commit sexual immorality. You shall not murder. You shall not steal. You shall not covet or have jealousy. And then he says, whatever other command there you might be thinking of, it's all summed up in this one command, love your neighbor as yourself. This list is concrete examples of what love for others looks like in real practice. So the Torah here is a valid gauge for discerning God's will and provides a helpful starting point for all ethical practice. Without actual commands, love is merely empty words without content or conviction. The key premise is that the Torah commands love. The Torah commands love. God commands love, and love fulfills the purpose of the Torah. We read, love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. However that works out in your life, Holy Spirit will show you. Figure out how to live in love and continue to have a debt of love, and your world will be a great place. That's what Paul's getting at. This sounds sappy. Doesn't maybe sound that spiritual to people, but it's the message of Paul. It's the message of Jesus. A new command to give you. Love each other. We can get wrapped up in all kinds of complicated theology, but here it is. Love. It's the solid, concrete way to live. Now to Romans chapter 13, 11 to 14. And he says, do this love, understanding the present time. The hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is nearly over. The day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let's behave decently, as in the daytime, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy. Rather, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ, and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the flesh. Live in the day. Obey these commands, because they are the will of God for you, we read in chapter 12. His good, pleasing, and perfect will for you, the renewed mind understands this. Paul gives a reason here to live like this. We are living in a time where we must be awake and know that the return of Christ is real. So he says, wake up. The hour has come. Interesting word here for time. It's not the minute or hour on the clock, but it's a critical moment in the history of mankind. In light of this kairos moment, that's the Greek word here, Paul issues three commands. In this opportune moment in your life, in this once-in-a-lifetime moment in time, at this critical juncture of time, this is the right way to act. This is the proper way to act in the right time. This is the time. This will be your finest hour. And it's more than 60 minutes. It's this juncture in time. Jesus said in Matthew 26, the hour is at hand. My hour has arrived. The hour has arrived for the Son of Man to be crucified for the sins of the world. That's what it talks about, critical juncture. It's wake-up time. It's living in the light time for you and I. Jesus is coming back. This kairos time is described with a striking mixture of metaphors. It's time to wake up. End time salvation is very near. Christ is coming back. The night is ending and the light of Jesus is approaching. All of the images are familiar to the Jewish world. They had this great idea of salvation and liberation at the end time. They couldn't wait. The moment for the completion of salvation is much closer than when the Christians first believed and were baptized. About 20 years for the oldest believers here. But we're still waiting. Day and night are contrasting concepts, just describing good and evil. The day is parallel to the salvation, which is near. Christ is coming back to fully deliver us. Sleep is a negative image here, symbolizing the inactivity of the mind, even the complete abandonment of thinking. And Paul says, wake up. Wake-up language means to be mentally alert, to be ready for the day of the Lord. Night and day combined with sleep and wakefulness picture life either far from God or in the presence of God, in the presence of light. It is important to note that the night has not ended, but it's far advanced. The light of day has not yet come, but it soon will, and we look forward to that day. Believers in Rome live at the edge of the great change between this age and the age to come, and we do too, or on the cusp of the tension between what is and what will be. So Paul says, because Christ is coming, put off the works of darkness, put on the armor of light. Paul uses familiar imagery of taking off and putting on clothes. These are word pictures for abandoning the dark and replacing them with the light. No immoral conduct. You must pursue moral conduct. Get rid of it, immoral conduct. Thoroughly wash and clean. Today we're familiar with the word a deep clean. That's what Paul's calling for, a deep clean of the mind and the heart. And the context suggests two kinds of change of clothing, from night clothing to day clothing, and clothing with the gear of war, an armor of light. And that would be protection. Armor is protection. So the first action is getting rid of works of darkness, the values and conduct of a tired and inactive mind, a mind that isn't renewed. The second action is what to put on. Put on the armor of light. It indicates preparation for warfare. And that's on Paul's mind here, as it is in other letters that he writes. He is not simply calling for a new set of clothes, but for preparing for a war that must be won. Proper Christian conduct abandons sexual orgies, drunkenness, debauchery, rivalry, jealousy. This behavior was common in Roman times, in Roman taverns at the time. Sexual sin obviously happens, can happen during the day as well, but it keeps with this light and dark metaphor. Avoid the dark. Evil is usually associated with dark and the good with light. While Paul details only the negative behavior to be avoided at night, the counter behavior would be sobriety, mental alertness, solidarity with Jesus and with others, I would say. He says, put on the Lord Jesus. Put on. That's the kind of clothes. It's an image of the armor of the Lord Jesus coming on us, his clothing. It's new clothing, and it can avoid the drives of the flesh of darkness. We can be taught by him. Put him on. We can be apprenticed under him. Let's put him on. And he has given us his spirit, so we have a supernatural ability to actually walk in the light as he is in the light. We don't have to walk in darkness. Paul commands to repay evil with evil. And so this is the way of the day. Paul reminds the Roman believers they must think differently than their neighbors. Offering your bodies as living sacrifices to God calls for a different life, which is defined by these two kinds of images, what you wear and nighttime to daytime. The time is now. Get up, put on light. So Christians are confronted by the moment with a sharp either or. What is the renewed mind to do? The pull of the larger culture to fall asleep or to enjoy the night must be resisted daily as we put on the armor of light. The call for us is to think and live differently. And this parallels the opening of the final arguments in chapter 12, 1 and 2. He said, do not be conformed to this age. He's telling us, wake up from sleep because the night is far gone. Let's live in the day. Let's live with renewed minds. Cast off the works of darkness. Put on the armor of light and walk in the day by putting on Christ. In 12:21, we read last week, the Christians are urged to conquer evil with good. Here, the Christian is urged to battle darkness and immoral conduct with light by putting on Christ. This present age is passing away. The hour of Jesus coming back of salvation is near. The kairos moment in which Christians live requires critical thinking and living, which is informed by light rather than darkness. We are in the kairos hour right now, the time of opportunity. Choose whether you want to be a child of light or a child of darkness. That's what Paul is saying. What are we? What are you? The major themes of Romans texts are found throughout the New Testament. Paul talks a lot about persuading people to wake up, see what's in the Gospels. There's to be expectation and preparedness in the words of Jesus we read. We are all aware of emergency preparedness, fire and earthquake preparedness. And Jesus is telling us, be prepared for his return. Paul is telling us, live in the day of light. Jesus coming back. Jesus said in Matthew 24, keep watch because you do not know on what day your Lord will come back. Be ready because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him. Luke records it like this in chapter 12. Be dressed, Jesus says, ready for service. Keep your lamps burning so there's no darkness. Be ready because the Son of Man will arrive at an hour, a kairos time when you do not expect him. Luke chapter 21, Jesus says, be careful. Your hearts will be weighed down. Your mind will be dulled with drinking parties, drunkenness, and the anxieties of day-to-day life. Don't let that day fall upon you unexpectedly when I have come back. Stay alert at all times. Be awake. So the night is associated with the present age that sets itself up against God. Followers of Christ, we face numerous temptations, worldly cares, the false glamour of wealth, all kinds of evil desires, but we must stay awake. Similar commands to wakefulness are found in other letters from Paul, not just in the Gospels. The call to wakefulness is consistently grounded with the return of Christ and judgment and the renewal of all things that awaits the human race. We are in our finest hour. Let's live in the light. Another theme running through these texts is the importance of armor and the reality of warfare. This reference to weapons and end times conflict is consistent with the parallel images that Paul has. He talks of weapons of righteousness in Romans and 2 Corinthians, weapons of divine power that we have. Talks about the breastplate of faith and love and the helmet of hope and the armor of God. We need this as we fight against darkness. He gives us a call to faithfulness. We need to live with the end in sight. We need to live with public integrity, to be armed for battle with the forces of evil and injustice. We need to be awake. We need to put on Jesus Christ. We need to walk in the light. And that means the church needs to continually be non-conformed by the dominant values of the prevailing culture. And we need to be transformed by the renewal of our minds, our thinking. So Paul draws this inference. Let's put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. I did a bit of research on this. What was Rome like at night in those days? It's hard for us now who live in populated areas to imagine just how dark it could have been at night in the ancient world. There's parts of the world we can still see this, but we have streetlights. They didn't have streetlights or any even the ambient light of a city skyline. There was only the moon. On top of that, there was very little of what we would call police presence at night in the city of Rome in the first century. There were squads of night watchmen who walked the streets, but a person had to be caught in the act of committing a crime in order to be persecuted. You couldn't just have witnesses. So that made criminals quite bold at night. Bad things happened at night. In fact, even the murder of a non-Roman citizen would never be investigated at night. Nighttime was considered the realm of robbers and muggers, sexually immoral, the killers and killers who knew there was no system in place to investigate crimes after the fact. So going out at night in Rome was considered a dangerous enterprise. Most people stayed inside behind locked doors after dark. Paul says we do not live as if we're in the dark. We can't live like people in the dark. We have to put it aside. We have to put it in the trash bin. Anything that is not decent has to be put aside. The deeds of darkness need to be thrown out. This imagery is shedding something and dressing up in readiness to do some things. First, there's a negative side. Let's behave decently as in the daytime. Not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality, not in dissension and jealousy, discord, looking for fights. You only have to read accounts of Greco-Roman lifestyles or various religious festivals to know what Paul is getting at here. This is what they understood him saying. There was a party culture, like there is today, a party culture with wild excess, drinking bouts, sexual immoralities of every kind, violent quarreling. The lifestyle that happened typically in the dark in Rome, and for the most part in our time as well. Paul says, these are the things to throw out. Don't go after them. Don't watch them. Don't think about them. Second, and more positively, Paul says, clothe yourself. You're going to put off some things, but clothe yourself with the Lord Jesus Christ. And do not even think about how to gratify the desires of the flesh, the dark. He uses the image of clothing yourself with Jesus, as if Jesus is a garment. The same as idea he had in Colossians chapter 3. So those who put on Christ have robed themselves with the full array of the armor of light. So we're not battling this on our own. We have Christ himself in us. Ultimately, to put on Christ is also to be empowered by Christ. The metaphor here clearly represents putting on the full wardrobe of Jesus, his values, characteristics, behaviors, and the vision of God's people summed up in Jesus Christ. Love, love, love. For the Roman believers, what we started in Romans chapter 12 and entered in Romans chapter 13 prescribes a set of behaviors based around themes of love and doing good. That's the message. In the shark-infested world of Rome, where the believers lived in perpetual fear of the authorities as much as they lived in poverty, practicing family love was their best hope of enduring through everything together. They needed God for sure. And they certainly needed each other, not an either or, but both and, God and people. Where survival and in the darkness was a struggle, Paul says, be self-sacrificial, be a living sacrifice. Paul is saying the full theological vision and ethical sweep I have for you is to be committed to God with this renewed mind, and you will have holiness, peace, and love, even in the darkness of a pagan city. But they only can do it together. As they love God and love their neighbor. Love, love, love. So what is this? How does it connect to our daily lives, your life, my life. Jesus said, love one another. This is the greatest commandment. And an interesting way to love one another, as listed in these verses, is no sexual immorality, no murdering, no stealing, no jealousy. Imagine a world like this. This is the vision of God for our world, love. We need to run to this vision. We need to run away from the sinful behaviors of darkness. You know, there's nothing wrong with running from something. If it has the power to destroy you, run. If it has the power to destroy your relationship with God, run. He says to Timothy, he uses the word flee. If it has the power to destroy your relationship with your spouse or your children, run. If it has the power to destroy any relationships, run. If we are to fight the good fight of the faith, that will involve doing some tactical retreats when necessary. So here in Paul's letters, and here, the purpose of end times teaching is about living an ethical life. He talks about Christ's return based on living an ethical life. He doesn't speculate about when the time is coming. He said it's near. He displays no interest in calculating the time of the end. It is just simply near. The end of the age has begun. The last days have arrived. Paul knows that, and darkness is overwhelming, but the day is going to come. And he says, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. That's what's going to happen. So this new life in Christ means to be enlisted with Christ, this army battle. It means signing up for the battle of light against darkness, against immorality, against unrighteousness, against injustice. Am I living in the day or the night? Are you living in the day or the night? What are you enlisted in? This is an important moment in time for us. It's a Kairos moment. Where are you living? Where am I living? What are you doing? Is my mind, is your mind renewed and seeking after light, or is it dull and camping out in the dark? What are you feeding your mind with? Are we feeding our mind with the fruits of the darkness? It's not going to happen. Maybe we need to be woken up. There's times I need to be woken up. We all need to wake up. That's what Paul's saying. Wake up. So my question is, how do you envision Jesus saying this to you? Wake up! Is he mad? Is he irritable? Is he supremely ticked off? How do you react to people who are not living the way you think they should live? How do you tell people to wake up? I would say Jesus gently grabs our shoulder and he says, wake up. He's not a boss freaking out on us with expletives and slander and insult. He's a shepherd waking up his sheep so he can move them to green pasture, to still waters, to light. He wants to take us out of the places that harm our mind and our heart and take us to places of daylight. I will wake you up. He grabs your shoulder. He wakes us up. I will bring you into the daylight. This is what I do. This is who I am, Jesus said. Today is the day to wake up. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day to wake up and follow me. I want to read the Lord's Prayer in conclusion here in Matthew chapter 6. We need this. It's the desire to move into the strength and the mighty power of God. Pray with me. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Not just on earth, Lord, we pray for it in our personal lives, in our family lives, in our church lives. Give us today our daily bread, our daily needs. Forgive us our debts. Forgive us our debts, as we've also forgiven our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Deliver us from darkness. Yours is the kingdom, in the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. This is what Jesus does for us. He brings his will into our minds and our hearts. He empowers us to be able to say no to ungodliness. The Holy Spirit is in us and alive, and we are partakers of his divine nature, Peter says. And so we are able to put off the deeds of darkness, to have our minds cleansed and renewed, to seek after the day. This is the hour. This is the hour for me. This is the hour for you to wake up. Jesus is saying, wake up. Know what I need from you as a church, what I need from you as individuals, as a body of Christ, to go into this world and love, 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 love till the end of time. Amen.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. And let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Mighty to save, forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. And conquer the grave. Jesus conquered.